I'm Laura Paskus, and on Our Land this month, I check in with climate scientist Dave Gutzler. He just retired from the University of New Mexico, and we talk about the changes New Mexico is already experiencing and why it's so hard for policymakers and politicians to act on climate. Thanks, Dr. Gutzler, for joining me today.
Oh, it's quite a pleasure. Thanks for having me on.
So you recently retired from UNM, where you worked with generations of students, have done decades of research. You've spoken to the legislature, community groups, written reports for everyone from the New Mexico Interstate Stream Commission to the United Nations. And if I had to pick one person in the state who I think has done the most to educate us all about climate change and its impacts, that would really be you. So thanks for being here with me today.
Well, that's all very kind for you to say, and I appreciate it. From my perspective, I was trying to do my job. And so taxpayers of New Mexico paid me for a quarter century to hold this title called professor and try to do research and educate people, and that's what we try to do.
Mm-hmm. Let's start our conversation today with what we've already seen here in New Mexico. And correct me if I'm wrong here, I believe we're 3 degrees warmer than we were in the 1970s.
Something along that. I mean, all of these estimates are fairly rough. They're not precise, but that's a pretty good number. And that's warmer enough for people to feel it. Right? I mean, people that have lived here for a few decades generally perceive it's just not quite the same as it used to be, and we can point to all kinds of anecdotes about that. I have a photo of my kids who were small when we moved here in the mid-90s. Bundled up like crazy, like they were when we lived in Boston, to go to the balloon fiesta. And you generally don't have to dress up like that anymore, more often than not. And so just things like that have really changed. And there are many more quantitative ways to show that as well.
And what are some of those big impacts that we've really seen on the landscape in the past few decades that are related to this warming?
We see things like increased intensity of wildfires, which also illustrates an important point about climate change, which is that often the big impacts associated with climate change aren't standalone impacts, that climate change acts as an added stress on systems that are already stressed for other reasons. For example, because of forest management practices. We've seen big droughts, which are of natural occurrence. And since I started working here, a huge body of research has shown that huge droughts are endemic to the Southwest and have been for 1,000 years. But now we think that the impacts of those droughts are more severe because the temperatures have warmed up. So drought that we're in, by some measures, is not the most severe drought that we've seen in terms of precipitation deficits, yet we're setting records for low stream flows. And that's because of this added effect of warmer temperatures.
Can you lay out for us some of the future scenarios that you see in the data, whether that's, you know, things like related to stream flow in the Gila River, or kind of what some of our landscapes might look like and be like in the coming decades due to warming?
The really big impacts that we can project with certainty, near certainty, are that the temperature ought to continue to warm up, because we think that the principal driver of this trend in temperature is increasing greenhouse gases, and they're still going up. And in the Southwest, in the arid climate and in the latitude zone that we're in, that is, the warmer temperatures are associated with a general trend toward aridity, drier conditions. That means that our snow-fed rivers, like the Gila or the Rio Grande or the Pecos, will feel the effects of a reduced snowpack, which is another near certain projection associated with warmer temperatures. So we expect, on average, less water flowing down the major rivers and landscapes drying out with effects on vegetation. And that can have effects on soil erosion and things like that.
And so in thinking about, say, Albuquerque, where we are today, in what kind of time frame are we looking at for kind of maybe some big vegetative or temperature changes?
Well, plenty of folks would say we're there. And so really what I'm describing is a continuation of trends that we already see in the data. What makes things a little bit hard in terms of both picking out long-term trends in either landscapes or water metrics, and also complicates projections into the future, is that these trends are superimposed on enormous natural fluctuations. So we go back and forth and back and forth between wet decades or multi-decadal periods and droughts that can also last for decades. And so it's hard to say that in a particular year in the future, things will look like this, because in addition to these trends toward warmer conditions and more arid conditions, we have wet and dry spells that we think ought to continue into the future. And so parsing the different timescales of variability and change are really tricky, and will continue to be so. Mm-hmm. So I expect that we will still continue to have some wet years just due to natural variability. And the challenge for policymakers is to not let down our guard and eliminate planning toward a drier and warmer future because we just got some relief from natural variability that might be short-lived.
Mm-hmm. So I think it's fair to say that climate scientists have kind of been put through the ringer over the past few decades, from, you know, outright climate deniers to sort of people who maybe think like, yep, climate change is a problem, but I'm just going to ignore it. I'm just going to go about my regular day. It's too much to think about. But I think it's been encouraging in the past few years the number of Americans who understand human-caused climate change is happening, it's rising, as well as the number of Americans who say that they trust climate scientists. And I'm curious, from your perspective, if you've seen that increased trust play out in terms of what we're willing to do in terms of policy or planning or making changes.
I have perceived much more confidence in the ability of the scientific community to lay out what's been happening and why, and what is likely to happen in the future. I'm not convinced that trust extends to what we might do about it, in part because we have to be honest when we make our projections that they extend into the future, farther into the future than most people are comfortable, and certainly most policymakers are comfortable dealing with, and that they're fuzzy. And there's even less trust in in our ability to transition toward a future associated where our energy is driven by renewables away from fossil fuels. I think there's very little trust in how that's going to work, who's going to be an economic loser, and whether that will all work. I'm quite confident it will work eventually, but I'm not at all confident that we can meet any kind of short-term goals about reducing emissions or making a seamless transition to away from fossil fuels. Because that's hard, and the path to get from our current energy economy to one based on renewables is very fuzzy, and people don't have any significant trust that we can do it without pain.
So I always get surprised. I'm like, the governor just had her State of the State address and didn't mention climate change or water planning, and I'm all surprised. Or another legislative session goes past and the legislature doesn't really take on water planning or climate in terms of mitigation or adaptation, but it sounds like maybe you're not very surprised.
I'm not surprised because it's hard, and there aren't easy solutions for water planning, for example. I totally applaud the ISC's effort to put together a 50-year water plan, but putting one together and having it implemented with real changes associated with it that really address the risks that we face in terms of our water future is hard. It's politically really hard. And so it doesn't surprise me too much anymore when elected officials who need to face voters in the near term are somewhat reluctant to put real change into place in terms of policy that people think is associated with something might happen in the long term. Mm-hmm.